title called Samvidhana Simhasana Disha. And this incident actually shocked me. And also I was a little flabbergasted. In the same year, I also happened to read one very important book and also a very important powerful line. I will read that line to you. That is, the Shudras have been, as remarked earlier, left with the earthen pot full of empirical details that are thoroughly despised by the TTB as inferior. TTB is the twice born. The pot overflows in seminars and in magazines and government offices as and when it is required to overflow. The person who wrote this powerful line and who also wrote this book, that is Professor Gopal Guru, and we have him with us today. Professor Gopal Guru is an accomplished political scientist, formerly professor at the Center for Political Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University, right now editor of a very important voice of Indian print media, that is Economic Political Weekly. And Professor Gopal Guru's intellectual trajectory is also very interesting. If you look at his earlier articles like Dalit Movement Talk Differently, Dalit Movement in Mainstream Sociology, and Archaeology of Untouchability, and also his books like Humiliation, Claims and Context, The Cracked Mirror, and also experience his recent experience cast in Everyday Social, you could see a kind of trajectory. That is, you know, first mostly he concentrates on the experiential realm of Dalits, Untouchables, Adivasis, and later on you could find him locating this their empirical, radical empirical experiences in the context of Western philosophy. A few people have done this experiment. I think Professor Gopal Guru and his writer associate Professor Sundar Sarkar have been extremely successful in doing this. So, and also he is very regular at Neenasam Cultural Shibira, and I want to share one of my experiences of meeting him. That is, once both of us were watching a Kannada play and I used to translate that Kannada play to him. So that's a very nice memory of him that I have. And also we have Dr. Ganashruti to initiate discussion after his lecture. She works as an assistant professor of economics in Government Postgraduate College of Vijayanagara. And also she has a PhD from the ISEC. She has studied extensively on coffee in terms of marketing and education, and she has published in EPW Postscript. So now I welcome Professor Gopal Guru to address on the topic equality and social sciences in India.
Well, thanks Arvind for your invitation and you, for saying so many good words about me. I am particularly very happy to be the part of this webinar this morning. And I hope that this discussion and interaction would be fruitful from both angles. Mentioned to me that somebody said that it is important to make social sciences scientific.
Yeah.
That is a big challenge, and we just can't discuss this topic at the moment in this webinar. We have a different mandate to complete. So we'll leave it for some other occasion, but that is important. We don't want to give it up. That is important.
Yeah.
This is an important claim that somebody is making. Secondly, as you very rightly said, that you know, what is the place of experience in terms of actually producing knowledge, in terms of actually reflecting on the everyday reality. And our concern, myself and Sundar's concern through Cracked Mirror and now Everyday Social, has been to actually philosophize the everyday forms of our experience. Is there. So my talk will also have some bearing on experience. And I may not have many references to what I'm saying, but those references are coming from my experience with social sciences, the practice of social sciences in our country. I would also like to mention here, just by passing, that, you know, how is one actually making an academic journey of oneself? Is it purely social scientist, or is it purely artistic? Is it purely a poet or whatever? What is it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So as far as I can see my own journey, as you mentioned, that I moved away from social shadulkas, Dalit travels, to now doing something which is reflective, if not deeply philosophical. But philosophy and pragmatism go together.
Mm-hmm.
That is to say, if a person wants to actually do some reflective thinking and writing, one has to have some kind of pragmatism at his or her disposal.
Yeah.
That is to say that, you know, your philosophical angles and insights develop only through pragmatism. Pragmatism means you are actually dealing with everyday experience of yours. You are not actually gaining knowledge from texts available that are already available to you. So I think you have a pragmatic angle to your philosophical insights, and that is how actually I will look at the question of equality and social sciences. This is as you very rightly quoted me from my 2002 articles, how egalitarian are social sciences in the country. And so that is the divide, unfortunately. But the question that at this point in time, after 18 years, one has to raise is that how far that divide is relevant today. My social sciences are important, but has there been a shift in terms of the focus on social sciences or something else, particularly from the point of view of the marginal communities and groups? That will form the part of another lecture, for example. That also I will leave apart, and we can just find out some other occasions to deal with this question. Now let's come back to the relationship between equality and social sciences. Before we actually concentrate on this particular link between equality and social sciences, let's see let's have two questions actually. For whom equality matters and why does it matter? Second question, which is also a very important question, which has been widely raised by scholars all around the globe. For whom inequality works and why? So I'm raising two questions which are actually interlinked. Why is equality important? For whom it is important? And why is inequality important? And for whom it is important? The question is inequality at all important? Because normally our understanding of equality is the preferred goal. You want to actually set up a journey to achieve equality and to mitigate inequality. So that is the understanding. But we have to actually explain as to why inequality is also important for some people who hold a conservative view of equality. That is to say, you are equal among the equals. You are not equal among the unequals. You are equal among the equals.
Correct.
That's a very privileged conservative view of equality. Now, for remaining equal among the equals, you require inequality. Is it not? If there is no inequality, you just can't prove that you are equal among the equals. That was the case in Greek city-state. We also have Ivy League universities. So, and you have now IITs and IIMs and all that. Everybody is equal in terms of talent status and all that. But why do you, you require inequality, therefore, to maintain your own status as equal among the equals. So that is one function of inequality. Now, second justification that one can offer for defending inequality is that, inequality also has a motivating force. If there is inequality, those who are unequal will always look at those who are equal, and they would try to then follow the people who are equal. And they would then see that is the role model, that is the example, that is the example that we have to follow. So that is the second. So motivation. So ironically, Arvind, it is the element of envy. You have got a very constructive element of envy that you are envious to follow that person. Envy is not destructive. So I think I would request our participants to underline this point. Envy is actually a very constructive element, not destructive element. It can become destructive depending on who is actually envious.
Yes.
They say it's a motivation. And therefore, what happens, the inequality actually creates some will, some initiative in you that you should actually make a choice to become equal among the equals. And to make a choice to become equal among equals, you have to compete. Therefore, your different exams that are conducted at All India level, NEET, DRE, and all that.
Yep.
Is it not?
So, yes, sir.
So that is through competition, you become one among the equal. So you get that equal status. So it's inequality is defended on the ground that it is a motivating force. Point two.
Yep.
Point three, that, you know, once you get into this very, very remarkable, darling institutions, you are in a way actually contributing to the development of the country, society, and economic growth. You can always contribute to the knowledge society, knowledge community, and all that. Yeah. That's why people talk about this. So this is, so you require inequality. Mm. And if you don't, if you don't have inequality, you cannot imagine about equality. So there has to be a constant gap between equality and inequality. Societies have to be organized not on egalitarian ground, not on minimizing inequality, but maintaining the gap between inequality and equality. Yep. That is structural. Imagine if there are everybody is genius, everybody is talented, everybody is skillful. Do you require equality? And equality? Your equality will have no value. Is it not? Everybody, but it is anarchic situation. So in societies which are working on competition, market societies, societies based on asymmetries of different kinds, that will have this gap. You cannot allow equality to become anarchic, that everybody is equal in terms of talent, skill, and genius. Everybody is genius. That's why in Three Idiots of this Hindi movie, you are two people, not. So there has to be a gap.
Yes.
In order to prove that there's a genius, they are waiting for you to follow that genius. So genius, we'll discuss genius. This is a different issue anyway. We will not take it at the moment in this seminar.
Okay.
So at one level, you find if everybody is talented, it is anarchic. On the other side, if everybody is mediocre, it is also anarchy. So you have to maintain the delicate balance between inequality and equality. You cannot allow inequality to become abundant or grossly enormous. So I think that problem has to be somehow settled and solved by actually introducing reason. So that you have to be, you can't expect to go for absolute equality. You have to go for only relative equality. That is the reason they have to, one has to actually adopt and inculcate in oneself. And that's how the gap between equality and inequality is maintained. Okay, so that's the point one.
Okay.
Why do you require inequality? Conservative people who follow equality among equals will always support inequality because this is important for the development and growth of the society and nation. Now you require, where do we get this talent and genius? Do you get the talent and genius in social sciences, humanities? I'm leaving this question with you people. You have to answer this question. I don't want to give the answer because it's a delicate question. I may have my own answer, but I will hold. I will withhold this answer at the moment. Normally, in people's perception of the middle class parents and society, that it is these physical sciences and now IT, where you require talent, you require skill, you require genius. You require genius, talent, and that talent is available only in the physical and hardcore sciences.
Yeah.
But it is also true that you have a Nobel laureate in humanities, like you have Rabindranath Tagore, you have Professor Amartya Sen.
Yep.
Economics, you have Abhijit Banerjee.
Yes.
Yeah, so you have, but that people say that is an exception. Rule is that genius belongs to this category.
Mm.
And now, so there is a competition, there is a choice, there is a competition. Therefore, I think the moral character, moral value, mm. moral worth of these disciplines are much, much, much higher.
Mm.
Now the question, I would not take this position. I would say social science are so absolutely important. Mm. That's why you have social science in IITs, is it not?
Yes, we have. Yeah.
Yeah, so, but that's one aspect of the talk. Mm. The other one is people do not want inequality. Large number of them want to mitigate inequality.
Mm.
And they want to become equal. And not equal among equal, but mm. everybody is actually relatively equal. There is no ambition, aspiration for absolute equality.
Mm.
I would give another analogy. How do we measure the social progress?
Mm.
Progress towards equality. What is the established standard?
Mm-hmm.
If you are teaching in the classroom, Arvind,
mm.
and I don't know whether teachers really pedagogically give this example to students,
mm-hmm.
how do we actually explain the relative degree of equality in the classroom?
Or correct. Examiner? Correct, correct,
take,
yeah.
Right? You take ocean as mm-hmm. the settled standard.
Mm-hmm.
And you then say, look here, from the sea level,
mm-hmm.
the sea level becomes one horizontal standard of equality. And
correct.
That's the reference point.
Mm-hmm.
From there, you say, you actually measure the height.
Mm-hmm.
Is it not?
Mm.
In the aircraft, or if you are on the mountain, you can then they say you are on some high altitude.
Mm.
Then see, you can take ocean as the standard,
mm-hmm.
measure the relative status of equality,
mm.
other values like justice, dignity. Mm. But we don't take this. I don't know whether in the classroom situation you take this analogy.
Mm.
So you. Those who actually are in the in favor of mitigating inequality, they will take this. We want to actually achieve that kind of a horizontal equality, sea level equality.
Mm.
So therefore we are actually fighting against inequality. And so there's a historical trajectory, social movements in India, social movements in USA and others are actually for fighting for equality mm. and mitigating inequality. I just want to mention that, you know, Thomas Piketty and others who actually are also having some problem with inequality because they create income equality basically. Income inequality can be, lead to crime, they can lead to fallen standard of nutrition, and education, all that he is giving a list of problems that are generated by income inequality. Similarly, Joseph Stiglitz, another Nobel laureate, I would say inequality is not good for growth. So this is very, very interesting position they are taken. Now, my point is that social sciences, how do you position them? Where do you position them?
Mm.
At the inferior level or the superior level? Do you want to compete social sciences with the other natural sciences? But people do. I don't want to, but people do. In their perception, they think that social sciences are not the matter of choice, but they are the matter of compulsion.
Mm.
We are helpless because we can't join the Ivy League. We can't join meritorious institutions. Institutions which are considered to be meritorious, meritorious, you know, with talent and genius. Since we cannot do it, and due to our subsidized ambition, we have to actually go back to humanities and social science, the same language course or something. And in their perception, these are not worthy of any kind of, important occasion. They are just, they consider it to be a pastime. Right? So, but that is a wrong, of course, obviously it's a wrong perception, but that is my understanding. But that is there in these people. So how do you actually then look at it. The one point is that one can always see the social sciences as important as natural sciences, not more important.
Yeah.
Why they are more important? Because they deal with human beings with reflective mind. They are not mechanical entities. They are not instrumental entities. They deal with human beings with passion, emotion. That's why they can't be scientific.
Yes.
And to reduce them to scientism would be gross injustice done to social science. That's a quick reaction to what was being said in the beginning.
Yep.
Social sciences perform a very important normative function to create a human being with values, human values, truth of being fully human, and produce thereby a decent society. The contribution of social science humanity is so enormous for creating, generating decent, harmonious society. But this is too pedagogical, too idealistic. People actually adopt a very instrumental view. How much will it really help me in getting a job? There is instrumentality involved in this. That is not wrong. I'm not saying it is wrong. But you know, at the same time, you are actually reducing whole social science thrust to getting a job. That is a little bit problematic. So we should not take a narrow view of social science. That's one way. The other one is, okay, I'm there in social sciences now. What do I do? How do I create space for equality? So this is the basic question in the colleges and in the universities and even in the school.
Yeah.
Now, what are the equality concerns? So we are actually expecting two concerns.
Yeah.
One is equality of resources. Okay, you require resources, you require tuition fees, you require other expenses to actually go to the colleges, go to the universities. Okay, that is enabling condition that Professor Sen would say it is the capability question. That you should acquire this capacity to participate in the life of social sciences. First, so there should be equality, but government then helps the SCs and the STs and now women and minorities as well in by way of giving scholarships, fellowships, and giving some other subsidies. So that is one way of mitigating inequality, making your participation in the higher education as possible.
Correct.
But that's not enough. You require to have equality of equal attention. And how do I do it? And since you are actually since people are listening from colleges, universities, and even Arvind, I guess, that your classroom is not without power. There is a power relationship in your classroom.
Yes.
There is a kind of asymmetry in your classroom.
Yes.
What kind of power and asymmetry is there? That people come from the composite background. They have language problem.
Yes.
They have social problems.
Yes.
Social background problem. They have minority problem.
Yes.
It's a mixed group. And then there's also uneven distribution of your access to education. So it makes groups challenging. So what is this teacher supposed to do in this kind of? That teacher has to actually give equal attention to all the. And if you are following John Rawls, you will have to then be morally upright.
Correct.
To give more attention to those people who require more attention.
True.
There are four corners. For example, in Delhi colleges, now Delhi colleges also there's a competition of social sciences. In all metropolitan cities, there are some colleges which there is a competition even to join social sciences.
Correct. Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah.
So that therefore, I think yet there in those colleges also some people land up in the classroom with different backgrounds because of different policies of reservation and all that, you know. Regional backwardness, like in JNU,
Report
was given 10 points, so people would come from that vernacular background.
Mm.
So the moral responsibility of a teacher is to distribute equal attention. Along with the distribution of resources, you also require to distribute this moral resource attention.
Correct, yes.
Is it not?
Yes, sir.
But what happens, you know, a teacher who is an elitist teacher, not that every other teacher is elitist, there's some who are, that teacher focuses only on a very, very privileged corner. The corner which is so accurate, so attentive, the corner which is so assertive, so articulating, that corner is a corner of students coming from a very privileged background.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you are focusing on that section or that corner, other corners will always be developing a sense of self inferiority.
Yes.
Some kind of isolation, some kind of alienation.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, what is important at this point is that you should actually develop that moral capacity, stamina to distribute moral resources like equal attention to everybody.
Yeah.
And that is the first dimension of equality and the social sciences.
Mm.
The second dimension, Arvind, is about recognition.
Yeah. Okay.
You have to also just follow equal recognition principle.
Okay.
That you are supposed to assume that everybody is actually capable of understanding complex things.
Okay.
And you therefore should really expect these people to participate.
Mm.
But what you do is you do not really actually expect that. You actually do not assume that everybody is capable, whether it is vernacular and this and that. So the person who requires to gain some pace in the classroom discussion and deliberation begins to isolate himself or herself from this, because the assumption is different, that these people are beyond any redemption, pathological, they can't improve.
Mm.
With that understanding, a teacher works, and therefore I think is a greater loss of actually inviting people from the marginalized background to participate in the sophisticated experience of the class. Now, what happens when such a discriminatory practice happens in the classroom? The students from the marginalized background, women, Adivasi, the dalit minorities, and others, they begin to take shelter in the identity thing. Then they begin to celebrate difference.
Mm.
And then they say in a very stoic manner, stoics and rastafaris in England and stoics in Greece, they would not really depend on somebody's recognition or certificate.
Correct.
They would say, look, go to hell, we don't require your certificate. We are great in our own rights. And that is celebrating difference is the another another via media, the another redressal mechanism to stay away from this. So therefore, your studies in identity, studies on difference are actually flourishing. But the question is, can you therefore really change the teacher who is not attentive to you? He would say, oh, very good, keep to yourself, do your Dalit studies, do your gender studies, do your Adivasi studies, but do not actually reflect on the larger philosophical universal issues. That is our game.
Mm.
It's our cup of tea, not yours. So in a way, you get reduced to your particularity. Universal concerns remain actually out of the limits of these people. Now you might say there is blessing in disguise. Social sciences are actually very good for these people, because they can successfully, unlike physical sciences, where because you know, a Dalit student or Adivasi student or a minor student or a woman, they can score very well in theory, but they fail in practice. There are many studies on this. So actually, you are in a way, you developed this kind of you anticipate future of discrimination. And since you anticipate future of discrimination in these disciplines of core sciences, you do not go there. You avoid joining this course. There are some people who join, who are prepared to take risk, and they go and join. But normally the students come to social sciences because they find a safe bait in social sciences, because you are anonymous. There is no practical, people do not as teachers, observers do not know who's what caste you belong to, what religion you belong to. Of course, religion, if it's a name, then you can find out. But there, the names are not, names do not appear in the newspaper, in the answer sheet. No, it's only fake, the anonymous numbers. So that is a shield that they get. It's only after a Dalit student gets first class first, and there is a surprise. Oh my God! Oh, no, this fellow is from the Dalit community. I never knew. So that is the advantage you get in this anonymity of social sciences. And so that's a practical. Do you get this experience, Arvind? Do you have any experience or evidence of this, or any example of this in your own life? Anyway, you can answer it later. I'll just stop after 2-3 minutes. So you have this advantage doing social sciences and humanities, and because it can give anonymous in the whole classroom situation, the hostile situation. Now the last point, Arvind, and then I'll stop. I think we can discuss. There is many issues. Is envy productive for the people who suffer from inequality? Do they convert inequality into an asset? The answer, unfortunately, is yes and no. Some people who are on the margin of equality or inequality, and I'm actually giving another dimension to equality concern, that inequality is the marginal dimension of equality. It exists on the other extreme end of equality. And that's why the logic, you cannot have both complete equality or complete inequalities. There is a connection. So inequality has to be on the margin. There are some people who, because of envy, productive envy, can move slowly, gradually towards equality on the margin. And that's how it happens. But it is not always the case that envy will always be progressive, constructive. It can always be destructive. And you find people, instead of following others as role models, they are so envious that the destructive enmity converts itself into enmity. So instead of following people, you have in Karnataka, you have cases I do not know to make reference to. We have been following this, now how within caste there is a tension and there's conflict. So if envy was considered to be creative and progressive, there wouldn't be any clash. But since it is not taken as creative and progressive, developmental, motivational, you find envy is actually dissolving into a conflict situation. So that is the point I thought I would make at this point in time. But at the level of social sciences, and I have not dealt with why are social sciences not egalitarian. Egalitarianism actually would always encourage progressive move towards equality with constraint. That's a sensible egalitarianism, not the choice egalitarianism. There are different kinds of egalitarianism. For example, if you have a choice egalitarianism, you produce objectionable inequality. That I have to actually I have to get 90%, 95%. I have a choice going to the physical science. But what about your freedom? You get up at 4 o'clock. You don't sleep. Your parents make your life miserable for good reason, I guess. But they are concerned about the future of their wards. But you lose freedom, is it not? So there's the competition for equality actually gets compromised with freedom. So in that case, inequality in that sense becomes very, very objectionable. So we really require sensible egalitarianism, where you can slowly, gradually move towards equality, keeping intact your values of freedom, dignity. So that's a larger question, and we can actually discuss it some other time, or maybe if your time in discussion space, we can always take it up. But at the moment, I think I should stop here. I think I spoke for about 35 minutes.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for a wonderful lecture. I have one question before I request.
Yes.
So one thing is that the epistemic contribution towards social sciences mostly comes from upper community, American and UK universities, Fed intellectuals. But the object of the study is, of course, backward, socially backward or economically challenged communities. So I think only in recent past this gap is getting bridged. So my question to you is that when epistemic construction of a particular discipline is mostly from upper community, so how we can understand the idea of equality in any knowledge production produced by one single large community?
A very important question, how to actually achieve epistemic equality, which is called in a different word, it is also called a democratic equality, that you are equal across spheres, epistemology, empiricism, and all that, doing poetry, doing aesthetics, doing drama, all that. Your talent is equally appreciated by people without consideration for your caste, gender, religion, language, region. So that's a democratic way of actually understanding equality. Now, there is a divide, as I mentioned in my article as well some time back. Why is that? Some people theorize, some people only produce and submit supply data, which is true in India and also across some, most of our people from India also supply data to people doing theory in the West. So that divide is always there. But we have to invert it. Inversion has to take place. So how do you do it? It's not simply a matter of right, or it's not entitlement. You require kind of conditionalities to really do it. You require training. Doing epistemic exercises, which is not, it's not a God-given quality that one enjoys. It's cultivated quality that you require training in that. You require to have that wherewithal of concepts and language. I have pocket full of statistic and experience, but I don't know how to make reflective sense of it, how to make sophisticated sense of it, how to make abstract sense of it. For example, question of caste, why we actually are gender exploitation. You have this experience with you, but you don't know. You have to actually share that experience with others. How do you share it? You require a specific universal language. You require universal language, not specific language. In order to actually amplify your specific experience, you require universal language. And that language can be generated through discussion, deliberation, communication. Therefore, you require to have equality of communication. You must, as I mentioned to you, you should assume that everybody is capable of participating in communication of generating a very abstract language. So you have to actually, if you are experiencing the same thing, if you are experiencing something, you have to actually share it with others by adopting, deploying some other language which doesn't really come from experience. It has to be generated by stepping back from the experience and then reflecting on it, produce the knowledge. Unfortunately, those who are actually experience it on a everyday basis do not get respite. You require some leisure, some respite to reflect, to think. That's why Baba Saheb Ambedkar had to go to USA for 3-4 years. He was away from his own experience. Everybody has to actually step back and acquire that skill and that knowledge. About your own experience, and then actually experience your experience twice over. That you are you are at the first instance, you are actually experiencing something as actual reality, a factual thing. But you are actually revisiting that reality with different language. Yeah, so you require more language. So that is, that training is lacking among the among those who actually have a first-hand experience. And those who do not have experience, yet they theorize, I am arguing that their theory may not be wrong, but it is inadequate. Because you do not get complete insight when you are outside the experience. You gain insight when you are both reflecting on it, also experience it at the same time. Look at Gandhiji. Gandhiji was experiencing the full producing. Of course, Babasaheb Ambedkar experiencing and producing very abstract formulations. Now look at his vocabulary. He's experience as a rhetoric. He's not beating his chest. He's actually giving a flight to his experience in different languages. So you find that through analogy, through metaphor, theoretical construction, all these three, analogy, metaphor, these are all important mediums to really give flight to your experience, which is otherwise very raw experience.
Dr. Gana, would you please unmute yourself and initiate the discussion? Yes, you're on mute. Yeah.
Yeah. Namaste, sir.
Namaste.
And can you hear me? Namaste,
yes, sir. You're audible. Yes.
Yes. And today's talk on equality and social sciences in India. And thanks to Professor Gopal Guruji for such a remarkable talk on equality and social sciences. And the two major questions that you...
Gana, you're on mute. Sorry, Gana, you're mute. You're mute. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Now you can. Yeah.
Yeah. And the two major questions posed in today's talk was why and whom the equality matters. That is, we all think about it. But one of the most important question is for whom the inequality is important. That is the most important question that is that has been posed by Professor Guruji, and he gives much more importance to inequality, where he says that inequality sets up a journey, and we need to mitigate inequality. And also, the most punching line is you are equal among the equals. And especially, he gave a special concern to the woman and marginalized woman, particularly. He has related his talk to our day-to-day experiences that inequality has been a motivating force and that has been a role model too. And one thing we often forget is the constructive role of the envy. And the envy as a constructive element has been a very different point that we all have to take care of. The normal day-to-day questions like why the competition is important, and it also creates the opportunity. We need to compete for the GRE, and I mean, those competitive exams make us equal among the equals. That's a major point. And there has to be a delicate balance between the equals and the inequality. We need to fight among the equals and obtain the status of the equality. And also, one has to speak about the relative equality. I mean, has introduced the concept of relative inequality, the gap between the equalities and the inequalities. And also, the one of the major question posed to us is, where do we get the talent and the genius? I mean, sir, it is better. I mean, a humble request is you need to answer this question. Where do we get the talent and genius? Because we have different answers for this question. And also the people's perceptions on the social sciences relative to the natural sciences, quoting the examples of Rabindranath Tagore and Abhijit Banerjee also. And in today's world of competition, he also stressed on the importance of the moral characters moral character is also much higher than the other things also, where we get ample number of examples where the moral character has been missing. And one of the most important analogy that he denoted is in our day-to-day teaching, the teaching in the classroom, how we need to relate to the equality by taking the example of an ocean. The relative equality or the relative equality as a measure of the height from the ocean and not from the mountains. And also there's the quoting the example of Professor Joseph Stengler, who said that inequality is not good for the growth. And finally, he stressed the importance of the social sciences as the natural science, and where most of the current generation always neglect the social sciences. And also, we need to give equality, relative equality in the classroom, and the distribution of the moral resources. Much importance to be given to equal attention to all the students. We need to understand from the teacher's corner and so. And that's it. Thank you.
Professor Guru, would you like to address the question on talent or?
Talent and geniusness.
Yes. You should click unmute button. You are mute, sir. Yes. Yeah.
Thanks for these two questions. I think Prashant Ingole, I saw on my screen.
Yeah.
Question: from where do you get this language, conceptual language?
Is correct. That
the question that fellow was asking? Yes.
Sorry, sir. Sorry to interrupt. Like, his question is quite important. Like, he extends it by saying, what are the process by which theoretical language can be developed through experience of the marginals? Like, he's associating theoretical language towards the experience of the marginals.
What are the processes of actually developing the conceptual language? One important process is the discursive process. Without that, you just can't actually develop this language. That's to say, you do not have innate capacity to develop that. You can develop that capacity only by discussing with the other, and the other who is also equally concerned about your problem, and he or she actually dialoguing with you without any conditionalities, but to share honestly his or her knowledge. So through this exchange, you can actually gain the language. That's the process. But it's a long drawn process, quite exhaustive process. Facebook and Twitter will not help you in gaining this insight. It can take you to that source, but it can't become the source itself. That's my critique of the digital. Though actually we're speaking in through webinar, but that's the limit of this thing. It is helpful, but not to the extent that we want it to. So you have to actually go engage with a person in a detailed dialogue and find out to glean out what is important for you for explaining, articulating your own experience. You may reject whatever is shared with you. You may actually rectify your own concept. You may actually assess how robust your own concepts are, how valid they are, how what kind of vitality they have. This can happen only through the dialogue with other people. There should be interlocutor with you, and that interlocutor should participate in your discussion process. That is the only way, only process through which you can acquire a conceptual language. Otherwise, it will be a Cartesian, that Descartes.
Yeah.
I think, therefore, I am. And this is for Prashant Ingole, who's, I think, somewhere in some university.
Yeah, he's in IIT Gandhinagar. He has
written. He's in Gujarat. Yeah. So Descartes would say Cartesian character. So I think, therefore, I am. For my mind, I don't require people around me. I can think on myself. That's also very problematic. Can you really be a great scholar without the existence of people around you? So that you require to have this very deliberative process through which you acquire a language, a conceptual language. Experience then can be elevated to higher levels of sophistication only through this. That's why you have people, but those who are supplying you language may not supply you adequate language. You have to actually modify it, give it a shape, orient it, and make it fully articulative in terms of articulating your own very complex experience of actually caste, for example. Yeah, this is You require a discursive practice. It's not a physical practice. It requires intellectual exercise, epistemic engagement with others.
So thank you, sir. There are a few questions, but I would merge two of them and put that to you. The first question is, of course, you have addressed it in one of your books, but let me take that. That is, Samir is asking that to understand binaries, to understand the left side of the binary, that is justice and equality, don't we have to define the right side of the binary, that is injustice and inequality? Actually, has done that is his professor has done that in an article, Archaeology of Untouchability, and also his recent works on that. And your professor also refers to Rawls. So there is one question about him by Samir. Samir has asked two questions. That is, Rawls talked in detail about justice, but rarely threw a light on injustice. So should we study Rawls with having existed knowledge? I think a little garbled. Should we study Rawls in the context of injustice? How do you see it? So to brief his question, he's saying most scholars study one part of the binary and they wouldn't concentrate on the other part of the binary. So do we need to study the other part, the negative, the so-called normatively negative aspect of the binary to understand normatively positive aspect of the binary? So this is by Samir.
Yeah, who is this? I'm sorry, Arvind, where is he from?
Samir, one second. Would you come on live? Would you take Samir on live? Organizers,
it's all right.
Samir, please on chat box mention your institutional affiliation. Thank you.
TIS Mumbai, this Samir Ayat, he is from TIS Mumbai. Yes, thank you. Okay, thank you, Samir, for your you must have asked this question to me before, I guess, but let me answer this question. You require, I think I've been making points on this, how important it is to start from the negative language. And that is my project for the last so many years now, that we start from the negative, not from the affirmative. But those people who are privileged, with privileged background, without any burden of caste or gender or race or minority, they can always start from the universal, from the tautological, as they say, from the affirmative language, like justice, equality, all that. So freedom, liberty, all these are very affirmative languages, and people start from there. Even Rawls start from justice. But what about injustice? The question is, which end supplies you enough theoretical vocabulary capacity to theorize? Justice or injustice? Even Rawls, justice is standing on the back of injustice. But in case of Rawls, and that is my understanding, maybe I'm wrong, there is acknowledgement of injustice, but it is assumed. It is not stated in so many words. That is, you do not have any chapter on injustice in Rawls' book on theory of justice. But it is already there in the background. But that is in this veil of ignorance. You are not actually showing anything. You are not bringing your privilege or underprivilegedness when you are actually deciding on the matters of justice. So that's veil of ignorance. It is all subsumed in veil of ignorance. But the question, the more challenging question is that, is there a possibility to develop a full length theory of injustice? And if yes, what are the possibilities that can be thought about in developing full-fledged theory of injustice? Is there a theory of injustice? There are people in the US who are actually addressing this question, the Judaism scholars, then you have Harris Marion Young.
Did we lose Professor Gopal Guru?
Yeah.
Organizers, did we lose him?
I think his network has gone off.
No, I think it's... I'm extremely sorry for this technical error. I think we have lost connection with Professor Gopal. I will just call him and get back to you. Just give me a minute. Yeah, hello. I just called Professor Gopal Guru. There is some connection problem. He'll come back within a minute or so. There are some nice questions, like we would take it. One from Vishal, I think mostly we have this gang here. So yeah, I would take it up that one. And one from Vinuta is also, yeah, we would see. Like I would try to merge one or two questions and then ask this to him. And yeah. Saurabh, would you please throw more light on your question, because I personally feel it's quite garbled, if you don't mind. Like the first part of it, person carry ideas right from the point when someone came in contact with structure, like which structure. But what is that which generates the idea of inequality among the person? That's very relevant. Does knowledge production by the modernist companies arm? The last question is, that's also we can take it. Easy. Okay. I will just call again and ask Professor Gopal. One second. Yeah, I just called Professor Gopal Guru. Like, you know, he's finding it difficult to manage his Wi-Fi, but we'll come back in 3 to 4 minutes. One question from Santosh is also very good. Santosh, actually, you know what? We discussed this question with Dr. Suraj last week. We have that video on YouTube, so you can check it. Like, he answered this question, like, why Baba Saheb is kept away, like his epistemic contribution is kept away from the social sciences. So that's a nice question. Dr. Sripad Kulkarni's question is also quite pertinent, but I'm not very sure. Like, I have, of course, I've read Aristotle, Plato, vis-a-vis Socrates, in the context of literature. So I'm not very sure if I do understand this question in the right context. And he asked, Aristotle said, how the soul is governed, how the soul governs the body, like superior governs the inferior in this context. Okay, social welfare concept, gradually decreasing development concept is. Dr. Sripad, it would be better if you clarify the second part of your question. Like, what do you want to say? Like, you want to say that Aristotle introduced, like, the Greeks have actually introduced the concept of soul to govern the body, and are you giving it in analogical term for social welfare and all? Oh yeah, Professor Gopal is here.
Yeah, sorry for this.
Oh, that's completely fine, sir. Yeah, we were discussing some questions. Yes.
So.
That's okay.
The second question was about the talent.
Yeah, that was what Dr. Gana was asking. Yeah.
And the talent, of course, is it's a very relative term. You just can't get a definite answer for this, because if I think that talent is not it's a degree of difference that people actually articulate their views. If you are speaking in a intelligible language, you are talented. If you are actually speaking in an unintelligible language, that is also talent. If you are speaking in an abstract language, that is also a talent. And that's a gifted talent, as they say. In mathematics, of course, there is a gifted talent. But if you are actually measuring talent in terms of percentages you have scored, and I'm not very sure whether we should call it a talent. You have a capacity to actually do it faster than others. But I think talent is a very relative term, and cannot be defined in terms of a perfect vocabulary. It is actually socially constructed phenomenon. And so I am not very sure whether I'm really giving a correct answer or adequate answer. And I feel very uncomfortable because I never considered myself to be a talented person right through my educational journey. I was a simple, ordinary student, but I always affirm what my ordinariness. If affirming ordinariness is talent, then I would take it as a talent. But it's a difficult question. Talent is actually proved through competition, making choices, scoring high. It's mechanically at some level, very, very artificial at some level. But what is ingrained in you as a human being, as a nice human being, as a decent human being, is more important than being talented. So the basic fundamental thing is to be a nice person. You know, a cricketer is talented, but if he or she is not a good human being, friendly, worthy of compassion, worthy of love, I don't think that that talent has any meaning. So you cannot actually isolate talent from a person's total personality. Talent is one part of the total personality. As I mentioned to you, the cricketer has to be a good friend, good coordinator, good batch teammate, a good human being. Okay?
Yes. We will take just one or two questions. Sir, the next one is actually very important by Tukaram Gaikwad. I think he's from this Tuljapur, I think.
Yes.
And also, I would combine this with another question. He's saying, in contemporary pandemic situation, we are taking recourse on internet, like these via media, that from three students, but large number of people still do not have this facility. So isn't this a kind of exclusionary principle of education? That is his question. So wouldn't this affect social sciences? We can take it like that. And also, there is one... another question from Vishal, again, this Mumbai, that is, do we need to desensitize conceptual language and expression? And also the other one, like there's one suggestion from one of Vinita Anand. She says that You spoke of sea level, but we have our marginals at the bottom of the sea. Don't we need to bring them to sea level with extra care to prepare them for competition? So what's your opinion about this?
The bottom of the sea is so rich with minerals.
God.
So you are, I mean, it's not, but there's a depth. You can always see there's also a depth to sea. But that's how it is. The question of equality is always a depth question. It's not a superficial question. And that actually proves my point, that it is so rich of minerals that if you are at the bottom of the sea, you are actually endowed with a lot of resources. Is it not? Why do people go deep down into the sea? Just find out diamond or what is it called? Some great ship, some precious stuff lying at the bottom of the sea in terms of vegetation, marine life, all that. So I think that let's not, it's analogy I thought was very, very commonsensical analogy, nothing, but I can always hold on to my own position. I see, by actually assigning significance to C. Oh, okay, so let's go back to the desanskritization. So why does one say that it is sanskritized? Westernization is not sanskritization. English has come from the West, no? And our thinking is both in Sanskrit and also in English. Sanskrit language has given us some concepts, and we are using those concepts in developing our own system of knowledge, and our epistemology is our whole thing. And this is there is a debate in philosophical quarters of our country, starting from Professor K.C. Bhattacharya's Swaraj in Ideas. So from there, I think the question of developing our own conceptual language, which is both in Sanskrit, in vernaculars, and other languages. In Kannada, I guess, there's a rich, it's a rich field of producing complex language. So is Marathi and Hindi and other languages, Bangla. So I think we should not really assign everything. You should not reduce everything to one language as the prime channel through which you can actually produce a particular theory. So no question of desanskritizing. It depends on what meaning do you assign to this process. It is also Western, it is also Indian, it's both. So I would not take this Puritan, it's only Indian that I will use to develop my language, my theory. No, that's, no one has done it. Even those people who are actually batting for indigenous language, they will also agree with this. So that's not the point that we should really labor on that it won't yield any meaningful discussion.
The last question was
the digital divide.
Yeah, digital divide, yes.
The digital divide is there because, our digital divide has come too early because of the pandemic. People are using all these gadgets, cell phone and laptop and other instruments. But now because of a lockdown, because of the difficulty in being face to face, only through the Facebook, it has actually enhanced the importance of this digital technology. But unfortunately, because of the resources, because of the location, you are facing a confronting digital divide. And as you can see in Mumbai, you find this disconnection. I couldn't get continuous supply of connectivity of Wi-Fi. What about if it is Mumbai, what about the villages? Will they get full-time connectivity? There is a first problem is possession of technology, instruments. Second is electricity, then continuous supply of electricity, Wi-Fi connection. Who will pay for this? They're all expenses, not free. If they are free, then I think it's a different matter. But now it is not free. It is, you have to pay for it. And companies are thriving on selling you. I think the sale of the cell phone sale is highest during the pandemic because people want to stay in touch. And why not? They would want to stay in touch with each other. through classroom, through community, through interpersonal relationship, but unfortunately there are no resources. So how to increase the resource, how to enhance the resources is the question that is has to be answered by the government and some other philanthropic activity.
Yeah, so thank you, sir. Thank you for your very meaningful words. Now I think there are a few questions I think on the similar tone and nature, so I would mail them to you later. Personally, I would like to thank Government Postgraduate College Bellary to organize this webinar. And personally and wholeheartedly and very humbly, I would like to thank Professor Gopal Guru for joining with us. And we had some technical difficulties, but still joined.
Thank Akshara for making it possible.
Yes, sir. So Akshara, I think he said that he would join. I think, but the problem is he has connectivity issues in his.
Yeah. This I know Hegadu is connected.
Yeah. So I will send him the YouTube link later.
Is it recorded, Varvin?
Oh, yes, sir. It's on YouTube. Like we are going YouTube live, so okay. I will send you the link later.
Okay, great. So, share it with Akshara.
Yes, sir. I will. And Professor Gopal Guru, I thank you. Thank you for joining.
Sir Arvind, thank you very much, and thanks everybody who participated in the deliberation. Yes, thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Okay, bye. Bye.
Bye, sir. Bye.
Okay, bye.
Now I request Dharnesh to render a vote of thanks. Dharnesh, or vote of thanks, helbeku anta kelkottini. Athwa ayojakaru helbeku anta kelkottini.
Shri. ಸರ್ಕಾರಿ ಪ್ರಥಮ ದರ್ಜೆ ಕಾಲೇಜು ಬೆಳ್ಳಾವಿಯ ರಾಜ್ಯಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ವಿಭಾಗದಿಂದ ಆಯೋಜಿಸಲ್ಪಟ್ಟಂತಹ ಈ ವೆಬಿನಾರ್ಗೆ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಿದಂತಹ ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಕೂಡ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳನ್ನು ಅರ್ಪಿಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಹಾಗೂ ಈ ವೆಬಿನಾರ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ನಡೆಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಂತಹ ಶ್ರೀಯುತ ಅರವಿಂದ್ ಮಿತ್ರ ಅವರಿಗೂ ಹಾಗೂ ಗಾನಶ್ರುತಿ ಅವರಿಗೂ ಸರ್ಕಾರಿ ಪ್ರಥಮ ದರ್ಜೆ ಕಾಲೇಜು ಬೆಳ್ಳಾವಿಯ ಪರವಾಗಿ ವಂದನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಅರ್ಪಿಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಜೊತೆಗೆ ನಾಳೆಯ ದಿವಸ ಕಾಫಿ ವಿತ್ ಕಾಯ್ಕಿಣೀಸ್
Professor Gopal, tomorrow we are having Sujana Kaikini to speak with us.
So Sujana, just a minute. Yeah, why? What did you say?
No, I said that. Did he go? Yeah. To all those who don't follow Kannada, we are having a session on music tomorrow with Sujana Kaikini and Ritvik Kaikini. Both are musicians, and they'll be playing several. Okay, I think he's. Oh yeah, sir is back. Sir, no. I just said that tomorrow we are having Sujana Kaikini to speak with us. She's speaking about Jeel Dalla's Gutari, and her brother is going to play some music for us. So we are having
great
music session.
What
tomorrow.
Time?
6:00, 6 PM, evening.
Evening, yes, fine. Because morning I will be busy. So.
Yeah. So that's why. Yeah, sir. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. See you. See you. I will. See you, sir. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
So all those who are with us from regions other than Karnataka, I request you to join us tomorrow for some English music and philosophy. So thank you. Thanks and bye.
We will email the links of Coffee with Kaikinis to the participants. Nani avare end maadi.
Why it is not leaving?
Sir, you can just click on leave.